Hello there! Welcome to a brand new episode of Character Profiles. Today, I've been looking at a trio of characters, a musical group more precisely, I just abhor. Oh sure, I enjoyed them when I was a child, and needless to say, the current generation seems to love them, but now, oh boy, do I hate them. I'm talking about Alvin and the Chipmunks.
Yes, Alvin?
Ever since their introduction in the late 1950s, they've enchanted children and annoyed their parents. And when we think they've disappeared, they resurface 20 years later. So, how did they come about in the first place? Well, the man behind the creation of these high-pitched critters was Ross Bagdasarian Sr., who wrote a song called Witch Doctor in 1958, which involved him speeding up the songs for certain parts.
And then the witch doctor, he told me what to do. He said that
however, the Chipmunks wouldn't appear till later that year for the infamous Christmas song, and thus, these monsters were born. The Chipmunks were popular enough to launch an animated series called The Alvin Show in 1961, and another one in 1983. With the introduction of these shows, their paper-thin personalities were brought to the screen. If you're fortunately not familiar with Alvin and the Chipmunks, here's the general premise. Dave Seville is a songwriter who takes in three little chipmunks he finds outside of his house and realizes they have some singing talent. The leader is, of course, Alvin, an obnoxious little twerp who keeps getting into one scrap after another, much to the annoyance of Dave. While some Saturday morning cartoon characters grow through each episode and are solid role models, Alvin doesn't. And as such, it's not a surprise why I dislike him so much. The next chipmunk is Simon, who is the brainy smurf of the group, as he constantly lectures Alvin with his supposed smarts, but gets wrangled up in his schemes anyway.
I remember it fondly from my childhood days.
Yeah, last year.
Finally, there's Theodore, the chubby one, who's also the most innocent of the group. He's fat because he eats, and he eats because he's fat, and he's fat because he eats. That's the joke. Get it? Ha!
Here's a peanut! I said a peanut. Thank you, Theodore.
Then there are their female equivalents, the Chipettes, Brittany, Jeanette, and Eleanor, who are pretty much exactly like the Chipmunks in personality. They didn't even bother to make them different. They are exactly the same in every way. In regards to the 1980s show, which I grew up with and am most familiar with, it's something that not even my childhood nostalgia can save. The plots are just generic and boring, the characters are one-dimensional, and listening to those squeaky, high-pitched voices for so long can blow one's eardrums.
Not a bad idea! The Chipettes and Chipmunks, starring in That Chipmunks and Your Eyes on a Dynamite Act! A three-ring attraction! Theodore, drum roll please!
I definitely enjoyed this show when I was younger, and the fact that I dislike it now shows that this was one of those Saturday morning shows that doesn't appeal to older viewers. That said, I've seen worse animated series from that period, but the fact that this lasted 7 seasons and 102 episodes is insane. The popularity of the series was enough to lead to the creation of a feature film in 1987 titled The Chipmunk Adventure. Ross Bagdasarian Jr. and his wife and producing partner Janice Carmen funded the film themselves, and it was a slow production as they also had to deal with making the show at the same time. The failure of Disney's The Black Cauldron did allow them to hire some of the best animators into business, most notably Glenn Keane. That's right, he went from animating this, to this, to this. As for the film itself, as somebody who doesn't like the Chipmunks, I feel no shame in saying that I hate it. As a barren plot, one-dimensional characters, unfunny humor, ridiculously stupid villains, and once again, most irritating of all, are those annoying, high-pitched chipmunk voices, with Theodore especially grating on my nerves here. If you're a fan of the Chipmunks, knock yourself out. But if you're like me and hate them, these are 75 minutes of film you should definitely stay away from. Thankfully, this thing bombed at the box office, leading to no unfortunate sequels. After Alvin and the Chipmunks ended its run in 1990, they disappeared after a while. But they resurfaced again in their worst form yet.
Will you guys knock it off? It's 3 in the morning. Alvin?
Alvin and the Chipmunks.
In 2007, they would turn into CGI animals in a live-action adaptation. And right from the teaser, it was obvious that these chipmunks would not only be updated, this would be their worst incarnation.
Whoa, Theodore, did you just...
Relax, Dave. It's just a raisin.
Prove it. Okay.
You owe me big time.
Wow. Just wow. Fox just decided to use a computer animated chipmunk eating another one's feces to market one of their family films, because I guess there's an audience for 2 chipmunks, 1 cup. Well, I don't think that many people would be interested in this. However, due to a surprising lack of family films during the Christmas 2007 season, Alvin and the Chipmunks was a massive hit, grossing over $217 million domestically. The film itself, meanwhile, is just awful, lazy, uninspired tripe. The screenplay is cliched and unfunny, the characters even more annoying than they were before, and talented comedians Jason Lee and David Cross phone in their performances, all getting a nice paycheck in the process. And what is the point of getting Justin Long to voice Alvin if you're gonna speed up his voice anyway? Add in them making hip-hop tunes even more irritating than usual by speeding them up, and an uninteresting plotline, and this is a film that has cash-in written all over it.
Ow! Wow, chicka wow wow, chicka wow wow. Tell her she completes you! Waiting for the rinse cycle.
Unfortunately for us, a sequel was put into development, which brought back the Chipettes, and they actually had the gall to name it the incredibly stupid title of Alvin the Chipmunks, The Squeakquel. Thankfully, it had competition for Disney's wonderful return to hand-drawn animation, The Princess and the Frog. And I thought, well, maybe parents who had to sit for the first one will be smart enough to take the offspring to something good this time around. And it was then I learned I shouldn't underestimate the general public. The Squeakquel made about $220 million, which is $115 million more than The Princess and the Frog made. Why? I have absolutely no idea. Any sane person can see which was the superior effort, and it pains me incredibly that a cheap cash grab captured people's attention more than an excellent piece of cinema that took 4 years of hard work, dedication, and talent to create. What parents actually thought that Alvin the Chipmunks would be a better family outing than a critically acclaimed, Academy Award nominated, and completely magical experience? Where is the appeal behind these obnoxious rodents? I don't get it. Could the people who've paid to see Alvin the Chipmunks explain why? Because it's been racking my brain ever since it opened how this could make more money. And once Alvin the Chipmunks 3D opens later next year, please, for all that is good, don't go see it. Pixar's new feature coming out around that time, go see that instead. Please don't make a sore excuse for family entertainment gross over $200 million again. And now for my fan work of choice, I'm choosing a bit of fan art featuring the 80s chipmunks beating the newer ones over the head with guitars. It was actually kind of hard considering a lot of fan works out there are positive ones, but I think we all feel like this when seeing the trailers for the new films, or at least I do. So those are Alvin the Chipmunks. Three characters I really liked when I was younger, but I hate them now. And I wouldn't be surprised if the Kerr generation, who drove the squeakquel to big numbers, will feel the same way in about 15 years. Alvin the Chipmunks started off as a gimmick, and will continue being a gimmick. And once again, if you pay to see the squeakquel over the Princess and the Frog, please comment explaining why, because I'm really confused who would do something like that. Now, I have to go edit this, but at least afterwards, I won't have to subject myself to these high-pitched songs anymore. Alvin? Alvin? Alvin!